Penguin Random House Audio presents The Devil Aspect, or Where the Devil Hides. The Strange Truth Behind the Occurrences at Hrad Orlu Asylum for the Criminally Insane, by Craig Russell. Read for you by Julian Rhind-Tutt.
The heart of man is the place the devil dwells in. I feel sometimes a hell within myself. Thomas Brown, 1605 to 1682. Prologue. The appearance of that voice, of that dark personality, was like some terrible black sun dawning, filling the castle's tower room with a shining darkness, and sinking with malice deep into the dense, thick stone of its ancient walls. Despite the patient being securely fastened to the examination couch, Viktor felt strangely isolated, vulnerable, afraid. What he was hearing didn't make sense. It could not be. Viktor realized this voice was not simply some fragment of his patient's splintered personality. This was something else, something other, something much worse.
I can sense your fear, said Mr. Hobbs. I am attuned to the fear of men. It is the energy which renews me, and you renew me now. You have sought me out, and now you have found me. You want to know what I think, what I feel. Well, let me tell you. When I killed them, when I killed all those people, did all those terrible things to them, I enjoyed every second of it. I did what I did because of the dark pleasures it brought. Their pain and their fear were like fine wines to me. I especially liked it when, at the end, they begged for their lives. When they did that, and they all did that eventually, I would pretend to hesitate and see in their eyes the glimmer of a faint, final, desperate hope. I let them have that for an instant. Then I took it away. It was that extinguishing of their very last hope, that I savored more than anything, more even than the extinguishing of their lives. You see, Dr. Kosárek, it was at that moment that they would feel the presence of the devil and beg God to come and deliver them from him. And it was at that moment that I made them see, that they finally realized, that God had been there all along. It was then they realized that the devil is just God in his night attire. Part 1. A Place Where Evil is Bound. Chapter 1. In the late autumn of 1935, Dr. Viktor Kosárek was a tall, lean man in his 29th year. He was handsome, but not that unexceptionable handsomeness that most of the Bohemian race possess. There was a hint of ancient nobility about his long, slender nose, high-angled cheekbones, and hard blue-green eyes beneath dark-arched eyebrows and raven-black hair. At an age where many still look boyish, Viktor Kosarek's rather severe features made him look older than he actually was. A guised maturity and accidental authority that aided him in his work. As a psychiatrist, it was Viktor's professional duty to unfold inner secrets, to shine a light into the most shadowed, most protected corners of his patients' minds. And those patients would not release their closest held secrets, deliver their darkest despairs and desires into the hands of a mere boy. It was night, and it was raining, a chill rain that spoke of the season's turning, when Viktor left his rented apartment for the last time. Because he had so much luggage and his provincial train was leaving from Masaryk station on Hibernska Street rather than Prague main station, he had taken a taxi. Also because he had so much luggage, a large trunk and two heavy suitcases, and because he knew how difficult it could be to secure a porter,
he had timed his arrival at the station with 3/4 of an hour to spare. It was just as well, because once paid, the Dürer taxi driver simply deposited the luggage on the pavement outside the station's main entrance and drove off. Viktor had hoped his friend, Philip Starosta, would have been there to see him off and to help with the luggage, but the increasingly unreliable Philip had called off at the last minute. It meant Viktor had no option but to leave his baggage where it was and go off in search of a porter, which took him a good 10 minutes. He guessed that the absence of porting staff had something to do with the commotion inside the station, the urgent shouts and cries that Viktor could now hear but which were out of his sight. Eventually he secured a young station attendant of about 16 in an oversized red kepi who, despite his slight build, swung the trunk and cases onto his porter's trolley with ease. They were heading into the station when a Praga Alfa in police colours pulled up into the rank that Viktor's taxi had just vacated. 2 uniformed officers leapt from the car and ran across their path and into the station. "What's going on?" Viktor asked the boy porter, whose shoulders shrugged somewhere in his loosely fitted uniform jacket.
"I heard a lot of shouting," he said, "just before you called me over. Didn't see what was going on, though."
Following the boy and his luggage into the station, Viktor could see right away that some significant drama was unfolding. Over in a far corner of the concourse, a large crowd was clustering like iron filings drawn to a magnet, leaving the main hall almost empty. Viktor noticed that the 2 newly arrived policemen had joined a number of other officers trying to disperse the crowd. Someone concealed by the cluster of people was shouting. A male voice. A woman, also hidden by the throng, screamed in terror.
"She's a demon!"
yelled the man's voice, hidden by the curtain of onlookers.
"She's a demon sent by the devil! Satan!"
There was a pause, then, in an urgent tone of frightened warning.
"He's here now! Satan is here! Satan has come amongst us!"
"Stay here," Viktor ordered the porter. He walked briskly across the station hall and shouldered his way through to the front of the crowd, which had formed in a police-restrained semicircle. As he pushed through, he heard a woman whisper in dark excitement to her friend.
"Do you think it's really him? Do you think he's Leather Apron?"
Viktor could see now the source of the cries. A man and a woman. Both looked terrified. The woman because she was being held from behind by the man, who had a large kitchen knife to her throat. The man terrified for reasons known only to himself.
"She's a demon!"
the man yelled again.
"A demon sent from hell! See how she burns!"
Viktor could see that the woman was well-dressed and prosperous-looking, while her captor wore a working man's garb of battered cap, collarless shirt, coarse serge jacket, and bagged corduroy trousers. At first glance, it was obvious they were not a couple, and he suspected the woman had been seized at random. The wild, darting, wide-eyed gaze of the young man indicated to Viktor the existential terror of some schizophrenic episode. A single police officer stood closer than his colleagues to the couple, his hand resting on his undrawn pistol. "Keep it holstered," thought Viktor. "Don't add to his sense of threat." He pushed through the front rank of onlookers and was immediately restrained by 2 policemen who seized him roughly.
"Get back," a Slovak accent commanded. "Why can't you ghouls?"
"I'm Dr. Viktor Kosárek of the Bochnitzer Asylum," protested Viktor, wriggling to wrest his arms free from the policeman's restraint. "I'm a clinical psychiatrist. I think I can be of help here."
"Ah."
The Slovak nodded to the other officer, and they both released their grip on Viktor.
"Is he one of yours? An escapee?"
"Not that I know of. Definitely not one of my patients. But wherever he's from, he's clearly in the midst of a psychotic episode. Paranoid delusions. Schizophrenia."
"Pavel!"
The Slovak called over to the policeman who stood with his hand still resting on his gun holster.
"There's a head case doctor here."
"Send him over,"
said the officer without taking his eyes from captor and captive. "I need you to disperse this crowd," Viktor said quietly to the Slovak policeman as he stepped from the throng. "They're hemming him in. The more anxious he gets, the more threatened he feels, the greater danger the young lady is in. The Slovak nodded, and with renewed urgency and determination, he and his fellow officers pushed and cajoled the crowd into a retreat from the drama. Viktor went over to the policeman the Slovak had addressed as Pavel. You're the
head shrinker. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.